A very good afternoon to everyone present here. On behalf of the West Bengal National University of Juridical Sciences, I would like to welcome you all to the 9th Durga Das Basu Endowment Lecture. The lecture will be delivered by Professor Upendra Bakshi. Professor Bakshi is a professor of law and development at Warwick University, UK, and an eminent scholar in the constitutional law. He shall be delivering the lecture on demonstrance and the independence of judiciary, the NJAC decision and beyond. The lecture shall be presided by a very special guest, Honorable Justice Tarun Chatterjee, former judge of the Supreme Court of India. We also have with us Dr. Saradhindu Basu, Justice Durga Das Basu's son, as the guest of honor today. On behalf of the university, I would like to thank all the dignitaries for joining us today. Professor Upendra Bakshi has been a professor of law and development at the University of Warwick since 1996. After serving as a professor of law at the University of Delhi from 1973 to 1990. He then served as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Delhi from 1990 to 1996. He has also served as the Vice Chancellor of the University of South Gujarat and the Honorary Director of the Indian Law Institute. He was also the President of the Indian Society of International Law from 1992 to 1995. Professor Bakshi graduated from Gujarat University in Rajkot and then went on to study law at the University of Bombay. He also holds LLM degrees from the University of Bombay and University of California at Berkeley, where he was also awarded a doctorate in juristic sciences. He has also been awarded the honorary doctorate in law by NLSIU Bangalore and the University of La Trobe in Melbourne. Professor Bakshi has numerous books and articles to his credit and is one of the biggest constitutional scholars that the country has seen. He has also been awarded the Padma Shri by the Government of India in 2011. We welcome you on behalf of the university, sir. Justice Tarun Chatterjee was born on 14th January 1945. He was enrolled as an advocate in 1970 and practiced in the High Court in civil, criminal, constitutional and revenue cases. He was appointed as a permanent judge of the Calcutta High Court on 6th August 1990. He then took oath as the Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court on 31st January 2003. He was then appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of India on 24th August 2004. He then retired after serving in that position in 2010. He was also the chairperson of the Uttar Pradesh Human Rights Commission from 2013 to 2015. I would now like to request the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. P. Ishwarabad, to deliver the welcome speech and felicitate the dignitaries.
Honorable Justice Tarun Chatterjee, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, Professor Upendra Bakshi, Dr. Saradhindu Basu, Madam Prema Bakshi, all the invitees, faculties, students, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure in welcoming this gathering to the 9th D.D. Basu Endowment Lecture. D.D. Basu Endowment Lecture was established by his family members, Dr. Saradhindu Basu and others. And during the last several years, very eminent scholars have delivered endowment lectures. They include Professor Mark Tashnet, Fali Nariman, Dieter Grimm, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Justice Rajendra Babu, Justice R.S. A.S. Anand, and now a very eminent Professor Upendra Bakshi will be delivering lecture, and the topic chosen is of a great contextual importance. how democracy has to contribute towards the legal knowledge. The prudence ought to be the outcome of a democratic process. Mere jurisprudence will not be sufficient. It is only when the community as a whole participates and effectuates the whole of the social energy, then only the aspirations underlying the transformative constitutionalism could be attained. He is a very eminent author of a very insightful books, very inspiring books, books which have a lot of original ideas which make us to think in several dimensions. Future of Human Rights, Courage, Craft, and of course, Crisis in a Legal System, Towards a Sociology of Law, then a Law and Poverty, Indian Supreme Court and Politics. So many books, so many articles and column writings have enriched the legal system, knowledge of a legal system. This endowment lecture endowed in the name of D.D. Basu. It has a lot of significance for the reason that the series of lectures has made a significant contribution to the field of public law. Dr. D.D. Basu is a great name in the field of public law. Constitutional law, administrative law, or law of writs, comparative constitutional law, human rights, or various other related areas. About that, he wrote scholarly writings, and his classic work, Limited Government and Judicial Review, is one which has actually enriched the constitutional jurisprudence, not only in India, but even elsewhere. Very eminent scholars like Paul Cooper appreciate this book as of a great importance. We have today Honorable Justice Tarun Chatterjee, who is presiding over this particular program. He is associated with the NVJS. He had presided over one of the convocation also. As a Supreme Court judge, he was visiting the university in various capacities. After his retirement, he is in Calcutta. It is fortunate that he is with us. Professor Upendra Bakshi, in spite of his age, health and other problems, has kindly agreed to come over here and deliver lecture. The love of the subject and love for the university from his side, these have motivated him to come over here. He was the holder of human rights chair professorship under Ford Foundation. For more than 3 months, he was here as a chair professor. And during those days, he had inspired and influenced the academic world here. Wherever he finds such opportunities to inspire, he will be definitely inspiring. In this contest, we are also distributing the prizes in essay competitions and competition in legislative drafting. This particular event is significant for all these reasons. I, on behalf of NVJS, heartily welcome all of you for this lecture. I request the members of the Constitutional Society to offer a floral welcome to all the dignitaries.
very much, sir. I would now request Professor Bakshi to deliver the lecture.
Mr. Justice Chatterjee, Dr. Basu, the real Dr. Basu, Dr. Durdas Basu, the Vice Chancellor, Mr. Abbas, dear faculty and dear students, and distinguished guests, and also, of course, Ms. Prema Bakshi, who has brought me to Calcutta. And today Munna Bhai was released from the jail in Pune, and he said about Manetha that she is not only his better half, but she is his best half. So I emulate Munna Bhai here in mentioning Prema. I'm delighted to be here. I know you have your examinations very soon, perhaps 15 days away. But you are a mahir of examinations. And you don't need to be told what Oscar Wilde said about examinations. He said, examination is a process where foolish people set questions which wise ones refuse to answer. You can go with a palm on your lips when you go to exam. Good luck to you. I'm here to celebrate with you, Dr. Basu, his life and work. But before I do that, let me say what a pleasure and privilege it is to be with you all after a long lapse of years, for which my illness is solely to blame, not Professor Bhatt. But I'm very glad to be back with you. And if I stumble here and there, because I've not fully recovered from my stroke and its after effects, please forgive me. Please be participatory and make up the words that I fail to make up. And the process, that is participatory hearing, listening. I'm very grateful to Justice Chatterjee to preside over this lecture. He's a very eminent jurist, and he would know more about Dr. Basu than I probably know, would know. And of course, Dr. Basu, being organically related to the great jurist, will also know more of Durdas Basu than I would. But I enjoyed being with him for a short time, and recently enjoyed reading his Limited Government, the Tagore lectures, which Ishwar Bhatt has done a very nice edition. I was talking with him today, and there's a put juxtapose Basu with what Ishwar calls post-72 constitutional developments. And he's done a remarkable job of this and the accompanying book called Constitutional Pluralism. This word I stumble on, so P, pluralism, I get it once in 10 times right. That's because the signal from the left brain doesn't go to the right brain. I can't help it. So it's how it is. LP, legal pluralism, constitutional pluralism. If you have not read the book, please do read it. Both the books are worth meditation. And West Bengal Academy of Juristic Sciences, you are still there? Or West Bengal National Law School? I think National Law School is better than the more imposing juristic sciences. I don't think we have evidence on record for India not having produced any jurists. I'll come to that in a second. But I've grown in understanding the Indian Constitution with Durgadas Basu. And as a young student in Bombay, I read his Introduction to Constitutional Law and many other books by him. And I marveled, and I have marveled since then, at his ability to explain a very complex and somewhat contradictory subject matter in with great lucidity, in lucid terms. My initial admiration for him grew in leaps and bounds as I grew progressively younger. My permanent age, according to my own definition, age is the measure of pain which one experiences when one comes across a new idea. So I'm permanently 36. I do occasionally feel pain at new ideas that some people throw up nowadays. But I generally don't feel pain by new ideas. India has controlled very well the infant mortality rate, but it's yet to control the infant mortality rate of ideas. And it doesn't know how to do it. 67, 63, 64 years of independence, whatever. Dr. Basu was a fighter for many a lost cause. And he was a fighter also for just causes. Among just causes, and I think he's the only jurist in India to worry about academics, law professors. And he wrote in his Constitutional Law Introduction, he said, I quote, infusion of academic jurists of the right order into the highest tribunal may lead to its enrichment, unquote. He recalled Justice Frankfurter was on the Supreme Court, and Frankfurter said, without qualification, that correlation, and I quote Frankfurter, between prior judicial experience and fitness for the functions of the Supreme Court is zero. There is no need for prior judicial experience for a jurist to become a judge. He makes a remarkable point when he points out that in many jurisdictions, academicians have been elevated to the Supreme Court or the Constitutional Court, like France and Germany and so on. And he was very critical of Article 2172, which allowed briefly for appointment, of course none were made, of jurists to High Court as judges. In other words, he felt that a judge who is not an academic in a Constitutional Court, and I recall Basu's first word, has, quote, no pole star of jurisprudence to guide him. And when she is most likely to drift into a turbulent sea, unquote, there is nothing to guide the judge. I don't know whether Justice Chatterjee would agree, but this was Dr. Basu's view. Dr. Basu was one of the few people in India to utter this same voice. But of course, while he championed for the democratic future of India, his voice has not been heard by successive presidents and the Chief Justices of India. The Russian Hill, they look with a durbin, with a, what is it called? Telescope. Is there any jurist in sight? All over the country, for the last 66 decades or more. And they'll not find any jurist worthy name to adorn the Supreme Court of India. So it's academic in the most pejorative sense to continue this life. But I'm addressing a new generation, and maybe some of you might adorn our Supreme Court, and I wish you luck. And Dr. Basu too. I had the pleasure of meeting him in print several times, but he called me at Delhi when I was the provost of Basu, Dr. Basu called me to congratulate me on my speech on 42nd Amendment. It was extremely critical because while I had welcomed the earlier Sardar Swaran Singh Committee recommendation, which for the first time said education and land reforms have been concurrent subjects, and I welcomed it, I opposed some aspects of his recommendation. The 42nd Amendment as introduced and passed did not follow Sardar Swaran Singh Committee report. And Dr. Basu rang me to congratulate me for having the courage to say what I said during the dark days of emergency. What is more, Dr. Basu, and I couldn't find it because statement is not internet archive, but somebody would, I hope, find it, a statement applauding the speech I made on that day in Sapru House, saying that we need more courageous people like Dr. Bakshi. And I was very humbled by what he said. I have many recollections of Dr. Basu, but I still remember the day I visited him in the 90s in Chittaranjan Park House. And I was very late in finding the house. It was rather late in the evening. And I went to Dr. Basu's house, and although it was late, he gave me Sunday and some nice Bengali sweets and lots of books and asked for one Guru Dakshina from me. And what was it? He said, Bakshi, do not, come what may, stop legal writing. And I hope that in a small measure I have discharged the Guru Dakshina of the Basu. I now look back. No matter, I know that even academics don't read me. I can see from the footnotes because I existed in a pre-internet era. I did most of my work till 93 when I first did the internet. But there is some, I put some of my writings on the net afterwards. My children have. But I think to the best of my ability, I have served the cause of legal writing and research. And, it's amazing that Dr. Basu would ask this as a Guru Dakshina. I'm not a guru, and I don't want to be one. But there's a message in this anecdote for you all. Never give up legal writing. Or if you've not begun it, begin it and never give up legal writing. That's a must for all people who would serve the law or the rule of law. Dr. Basu said many things about the Constitution. But one of the things he said, I must hurry, I'm not even started my subject. He said, for example, that we must step outside the worship of Government of India Act 1935. We must go beyond that Government of India Act. And Granville Austin, however, in his book, which has been recognized by the Supreme Court itself, says the following: history had done much of the work, but history means Government of India Act 1935. Our Constitution is a complete break from the 1935 Act. And Dr. Sudhir Basu in his limited government says that the difference we made between the skeleton and the soul of the Constitution. The soul of Constitution does not lie in 35 Act. 35 Act, the skeleton of the Constitution of India, maybe you would find it. And for many people today, Constitution is just a ghost, a skeleton. Jack Derrida wrote a great book on the work of mourning, the New International, in which he recalled the first scene before the first scene, the prologue, where the ghosts take an oath from Hamlet. And her first 150 pages of the book by Derrida, it's a very readable book from Derrida, is all about that significance of the oath, which Lord would remember. He also took an oath to the Constitution. We normally, when you take an oath, there are two kinds of oaths. One is swearing at the Constitution, I say, another is swearing the Constitution. Judges are fully oath being. Ministers are not fully oath beings of any government. The Dr. Basu said the sovereignty in belongs to the people of India. The sovereignty does not belong to either parliament or the executive or the court. Now this is a tremendous message here. I think he said it much before Professor Achille Hart in his concept of law. Professor Hart made the distinction in 61, but much earlier. Professor Hart at Oxford said, read that book, you must read it cover to cover, several times. Professor Hart did say somewhere that there is no such thing as sovereignty, but there is only such thing as supremacy. Everybody is supreme within the appointed sphere. Nobody is sovereign. But Basu said it way before Professor Hart said it. And he believed that constitution should be changed only by people of India. And therefore advocated a permanent commission which will meet every 20 years or so, like Jefferson did in America. He said that the Constitution must be amended, proposals for amendment should be by an expert body. Venkatachalaya, Brother Venkatachalaya was there. Assembled some experts, and there was a Constitutional Reform Commission in 1918. And I wrote an article which somebody reads in the Economic and Political Weekly, which was entitled The Kar Seva of the Indian Constitution. Can you do it if you have the time? So I disagree with Dr. Basu about, not about people being sovereign, but how the Constitution is to be changed. I'm more comfortable with their lordships deciding what the meaning of the Constitution will be than either the executive, parliament, or the other wings of government. Dr. Basu, of course, opposed undiluted, his words, autocracy, and he criticized Goloknath for that. So I have learned a lot, in other words, and I would not directly deal with it. Some of the minor or major differences I have with Dr. Basu that appear in the second and third part of my talk. I don't propose to talk about the NJAC decision very much, although it is in the title. Now, the promise of a title is never to be ignored. And why I have chosen to bypass it is a matter for you all to decide when you read the paper, if you do. I recommend you do. But essentially, the more I read the several judgments in NJAC decision of 2014-15, I feel the issue is obscured by propaganda. And why do I say that? And that interests me, not the judgment itself. All the judgment, I've written a lot on it. The judgment is obscured by heavy propaganda. Propaganda number one, and I'll be quick on this, because this is not my main emphasis today. The proposition number one was that Parliament has plenary powers to amend the constitution, and therefore the NJSC decision is not wrong. Now this is pure bunkum. Anybody who reads the judgment carefully will know that what the Lordship objected to was the NJSC, which had the near veto power by the Lord Minister of the Union, and what they objected to was the whittling away of the primacy of the justices in the process of selection of justices. These were the two objections they had. But they never doubted the plenary power of Parliament to amend the Constitution. That nothing prevents the government or Parliament from passing a new NJSC bill, provided it respects these two conditions. Provided it does not give a disguised veto to the Union Law Minister, and provided it does not whittle down the primacy of the Chief Justices, Chief Justice and Companion Justices. And I did suggest to the Minister, Union Law Minister, the Ravi Shankar Prasad, the consultation. I said you should go to the Supreme Court for an advisory opinion, because the last opinion in 1921 was also an advisory opinion, where you ask for clarification of collegial system. Don't go in adversary proceedings. I formulated some questions for the Honorable Supreme Court. Many jurists there assembled agreed with me. But the government and Parliament took a different path. It's all right. I thereupon wrote an express, Indian Express, therefore this is why I suggested an advisory opinion. There is no such thing as an attack on the plenary power of Parliament to amend the Constitution. It stayed in place since 1973 Keshavan the Bharti decision. And anybody who says to the contrary is a fool, either a fool or a knave or both. Although I don't, for the life of me, cannot understand how fools can be knaves at the same time. But I'll let it pass. You might refer to my convocation address and the footnotes distinguishing between rational fools and foolish excellence. So I would not go into that. But I gave a convocation address here, the only convocation address in the world which contains footnotes. So kindly, this is there, it's on the website or it's in the journal, or kindly read. Second propaganda is, the judges appointing judges is a violation of democracy. And this is a poor propaganda. Judges are appointing judges that, first of all, Article 124 and the companion article has been amended by the Supreme Court to require consent, concurrence for consent. Pure bunkum, if you read the judgment. The judgment relies on a prior judge's case and advisory opinion of 1991 or 93, I forget now. And the court clearly says in 1993 that the advisory opinion was sought only for procedures of appointed judges, not against the collegium. How the collegium functions. Of Dada Baba, who was told of majority opinion, said instead of three, there should be five justices in the collegium. Therefore, in the advisory opinion, Union of India Law Secretary filed an affidavit which said out of 400 odd appointments, only seven the President disagreed with the Chief Justice of India. What does it mean? It means there's no difference, there's no quarrel between executive and judiciary. So what is the horror of NJSC about? The judges refer to this affidavit. Then there's the argument that collegium does not work. Let us appoint the executive bench. Now, it is true, when my friend of Madras, I thought, has done a very nice book, what's his name, in just retired, on collegium and judicial appointments and transfers. Justice Chandru has done a very nice book in which he has quoted from six or seven chief justices who wrote their autobiographies, saying that they were badly treated when they came to the Supreme Court, when their turn came to be nominated to the Supreme Court. For the life of me, Justice, His Lordship, Your Lordship, I don't understand why. One age is fixed by the Constitution 63 and other 65. Why should not all judges retire 70? I've said it long time ago, several times. I don't say it now, but nobody listens. That's all right. I'm accustomed to not being listened to. But there are my reasons for saying, if judges are fit and able to serve various commissions upon their retirement, why don't you put a stop at 70? After 70, they will serve the government in no capacity whatsoever. They will come to the schools, national law schools and the law colleges, and teach if they like, or write books. There's no business to be in public life after 70, unless they choose to be. That's a different matter. But not as appendages of government, or tools of governance. Oh. But nobody listens. So I don't think this is an important matter for you to discuss and decide. As far as I'm concerned, as a citizen, I did not know how judges were appointed when the law minister and the executive appointed them. I have no means of knowing who was appointed why, and who was bypassed why, or transferred why. I don't know. I have no material record. Similarly, I have no material record apart from Justice Chandru's reference to various biographies of how many judges were not selected by the Chief Justice. How did the college function? In Evidence Act, you might recall, hearsay evidence is not permissible. All I have is hearsay evidence. Either the executive thing worked, or the collegium worked, or neither worked, or commission would work, and prophecy, political prophecy, the commission would work better than this or that system. Judges appoint their own everywhere in the Commonwealth jurisdiction. Apart from America, which is a different matter, where they send their appointment. And now there's a very interesting case of substituting Justice Scalia before the Senate, and the Republican Senate says we will not consider appointing anybody at all. No Obama, until Obama retires from the White House. We'll see how it unfolds. So I think judge's case you must read carefully, and careful reading A involves going beyond this propaganda, for God's sake. This is not right. If judges have written judgment, they have no other means of saying what they meant. So you have to read the judgment as law people. How long it is, and how diverse it is. But the heart of the judgment does not lie in National Judicial Appointment Commission. The heart of the judgment lies in recusal, which nobody reads. Justice Kerr and Justice Radhakrishnan, in Subrata Roy Sahara case, in 2014, wrote a 70-page judgment, which is worth reading, which I read only because Brother Radhakrishnan asked me to read. I had overlooked it. It will be difficult to cope with the Supreme Court. It writes so many judgments. But as an academic, you are bound, duty-bound to read. Why does the poor society pay you such a high salary? And my answer was, a poor society pays a teacher a high salary to do four things: to read, to write, to think, and to talk. If there's a fifth one, it's a whole examination, maybe, you might suggest. This is all we can do. Master, what can I do? What can I do? सोच सकता है, बहुत बकवास कर सकता है बारे से, और विचारता नॉट विचार द सेंस ऑफ द डर्टी पिक्चर्स का ओवन, जहां सोच वहां शौचालय, नॉट दैट. Soch means not soch, but soch. So that's basically what did recusal mean? Now, before Kaya and Radha Krishna, before that, there was the invariable custom, convention, that you would not ever refuse a recusal if counselable to mention it. And in this case, Justice Dave recused himself, saying they would be in the NJSC, where the NJSC would be held constitutional. So Justice Dave then came Justice Kerr, and Justice Kerr said, no, I'm not going to recuse myself. Here's the thing about lawyers, that you must read Radhakrishnan and Kerr judgment in Supreme Court of Sahara. I can't go into it. But he said, I will recuse only if there is shown, a demonstrably shown, a pecuniary bias. I will not recuse myself on all. His importance of his dissent, judgment lies not with me saying what he would do. He said, all judges must follow the oath they take in the third schedule to decide. And the following the oath rules out recusal on the ground of official bias. Now, administrative law teachers who know about official bias, Justice Goel and Justice Chalmeshwar say, look here, recusal is only permitted, recusal never permitted except in financial bias, but they say recusal is impossible because sooner or later every judge will either be a member of the new commission or a member of the collegium, every senior judge. And you become senior by sitting on the bench year after year. You don't do anything special. Am I right? You become senior by the fact that you also put your foot on the escalator. So you put your foot on the escalator, that's why you become Supreme Court judge, you put your foot on, you become senior. Now, Chalmeshwar and Goel say, Justices Chalmeshwar and Goel say, there is a defense of necessity. You know defense in criminal law? Necessity. That because every judge is going to be somehow involved in selecting other judges, you cannot follow third schedule and just recuse yourself. They don't go as far as to say, I mean, the way did something constitutionally wrong. But they did say that this is our position. And Justice Loku goes so far as to say, well, a judge may recuse himself, even if there is no final bias, but you must give sufficient reasons. In my speech, written speech, I have given five situations arising out of judgment, and you can read that. I won't disturb you now. But I do want to say that recusal is constitutionalized now by Justice K.Y.J. NJSC judgment. And the importance of the judgment lies in studying, there's the opening judgment by every judge on recusal. And then the judgment, second part, on NJSC case. It won't do to read the NJSC case judgment and not read the recusal part. You must read the whole thing in order to understand how judges think. So a five-judge bench has laid down constitutionality of recusal. And this five-judge bench was bound by 1991 or 1993 decision, that was the opinion. So they rule, what they rule, that NJSC is unconstitutional. They also discuss at length the doctrine of severance, where the severance applies to that. I will not go into that. You must read it. I will come to the main part of my talk, which is demonstrative. My computer spell check very kindly suggests that what I mean is demonstrative. And I fight the computer spell check because these demons are defined as having by the fact that they have no prudence. And the lords of the Supreme Court are certainly not they. They are doing their democracy reinforcing people. And I just came across, and Ishwar Bhatt sent me the two other lectures in cyclostyle form, Xerox form, and one was by former Chief Justice of India, Justice Rajendra Babu. And Rajendra Babu says clearly, and I quoted in my speech, I won't take your time with it, he says clearly, and this was a familiar ring, the Supreme Court is a political institution. And it takes political decisions. Somebody called Bakshi, he writes a lot, said this in his Supreme Court in Politics in 1980. Very good that his lordship recognizes. And he says further, he says, he uses this word, it's a democracy reinforcing court. These are his words, not mine. I'm very pleased to find them. And this is what demonstrators means. Demonstrators means that the court reconstitutes the demos and speaks in the name of people. And the court has continuously spoken in the name of people at least since 1980 through SAL. I call it my dying day, SAL, you call it PIL. You translate. I'll call it SAL. I've given my reasons for it. You can borrow labels from America, but you can't borrow history. And SAL has this history. But you people, you Americans, you use the word PIL, you're welcome. SAL is that demonstrance. SAL is not jurisprudence. If by jurisprudence you mean, oh my goodness, you mean 10 minutes more, no more. If you mean following the precedent, democracy of students cannot happen if we follow the precedent. My new precedent says you shall not decide any case of controversy in which a petitioner's rights are not directly affected. I've gone to the court, I've indicated the Honorable Supreme Court in SAL by saying you should be other regarding when you form rules of locus standi because it's a democratic, socialist, secular constitution. Bourgeois jurisprudence does not apply. You must apply a wider other regarding jurisprudence. So the poor people can't come to the court. They are brought to the court, that's another matter, but they can't come to the court. They are brought by the police, by the NIA, a number of agencies of government. But people cannot directly come. They need a medium. And a medium is social action, human rights groups. Journalists, professors, some lawyers now, like Prasanth Bhushan and so on. Soon, they bring petitions before. The latest is Shreya Sagar's case, which resoundingly affirms freedom of speech. And Shreya Sagar was sued till yesterday. I know her. So, a lot of people file these petitions, and court accepts it. So, demonstrance means has to decide a fundamental issue. Is there a text which you should follow? And the demonstrators say there are many texts. There is not only one text of the Constitution. that Government of India press briefs. That's very important. I have a thesis about several texts, I won't go into that. There are directive principles texts, there are social justice texts, there are governance texts, there are institutional texts. The Constitution is massive and ever proliferating through amendments and various laws. I won't go into that. What do you do? Others who, other type of people like me say he must look at a text in a context. What is the context? Now I have five or six categories of context which I'll simply mention, not elaborate. One is context forgetfulness. Demonstrations can't be context forgetting. To remember what it has done, said and done through Keshavan. Similarly, there is context celebration. There is context transcendence, going beyond the context. There is context sensitivity. And there is finally, last but not the least, context smashing. When you smash the context, this is the monster. Smashing the context of the past. And you must read the judgment as establishing a new context in place of the old context. Contexts are structural phenomena, not episodic phenomena. One must make a distinction between episodic and the structural. As Justice Kurian does in his long opinion, short opinion in the NJSC case. A very nice thing to say about structure and episodes, which he derives from me, and he has a passing reference to me also, but that doesn't matter here. But his Lordship's opinion is quite important for the development of the law. There is then something called, therefore, adjudicative time. Now that's very important. We can study Supreme Court decisions anytime we like and write on it. The judges have to decide within their lifetime on the bench. And that's a big, big difference. And we ought to remember it when we criticize every judgment or a trend of a set of judgments. I will not go into that either at the moment. How to responsibly criticize judgment should be the central question before all law students, legal academics and lawyers. How does one socially responsibly criticize? Criticism is out. Critique is in. You must look at the structural and not the episodic. A judgment cites many judgments inside. And you should read them all. If you want to follow the NJSC judgment, my God, it refers to so many judgments of the Supreme Court. The judges have an institutional memory. Maybe now there is an assistant there, but whoever, there is a memory there. And you read the NJSC judgment without looking at the text judgments they cite earlier. That won't do. Intertextuality is the context. Not the text is the context. Intertext is the context. So I ask the question, I will this I end. How are we to judge the judges in a demonstrational era? Long time ago, there were days of jurisprudence. They have gone. Right or wrong, they have gone. Principles of law underlying the judgments and the legislation are gone. We live under three prudences, I say. We live under legisprudence. That is the prudence of the legislature. Jurisprudence, that is the wisdom of the jurists. And demonstrations, which is the creation of the court. The court today, roughly, not merely decides disputes, it sets out policy which the executive has not thought about, like the interlinking of rivers. It monitors executive policy, like the Kaladan or corruption. The Supreme Court invents new jurisdictions. I said in my writings that Supreme Court invents new jurisdictions, and their lordships like it so very much that they borrowed my term. I said Supreme Court invented epistolary jurisdiction. Epistolary jurisdiction meant simply that we don't letter to judges and appeared as individuals arguing these cases. I appeared in several myself in the first page of SAM. Curative petitions. They've invented under Article 142 in Hora's case a new jurisdiction. The judges invent jurisdiction. They invent new enforcement structures. Like SIT, we did hear about SIT when going up. SIT is the den of the Supreme Court. Supreme Court thought of special investigative teams and appointed under and watched over them, whatever they did. And likewise, continuing members who never heard of in common law. In SL is not possible without continuing members. I'm still arguing Agrahom case, which was filed in 1980. I'm arguing before National Human Rights Commission that the result of continuing mandamus, the case will go on, and the lordship asked me, Bakshi, Professor Bakshi, how long will you argue? I said, I argue till the state of Uttar Pradesh learns the alphabet of rule of law. And that definition is impossible. The state of Uttar Pradesh will never learn. So I'll be forever in business. And I'm still in business. Now I'm before NHRC. Supreme Court pops out the jurisdiction to high courts, to district judges, to legal aid board, to hundreds NHRI, National Human Rights Institutions, and so on. How do we judge this process of judicial power and of judicial process? That's my question to you. And my suggestion with this, I possibly end, not too long, is A, you must go structural, not episodic. B, and for the want of time, I say one must have a theory of constituted time, and adjudicative time. And we don't have a theory. We have no think about the time element in the judgment, right? As if time is an infinite resource. It is not. Ask any judge and she will tell you. And consult any law ministry book on Supreme Court, High Court judges, it tells you can know where they are retiring. They don't have infinite time. Justice Chagla, I remember, when he was asked in Bombay High Court, law argued for only 8 days. Nowadays, law is argued for long, 30 days, 60 days, 70 days, 80 days. But that was that, 60. 8 days were considered a long time. And law suddenly realized that it had gone on for too long like me. And I said, my lord, I'm sorry if I've trespassed on judicial time. And Justice Chagla said, you're not, Mr. Counsel, you have not trespassed on my time, but you have trespassed on infinity, time beyond time. Now judges don't have time beyond time. Scholars have time beyond time, a whole life to write. So social responsible criticism must bear the typology of time, theory of time. And social responsible criticism must distinguish between what I call creative judicial arbitrariness and arbitrary judicial destructiveness. What is the creative judicial arbitrariness? SL is creative judicial arbitrariness, which arbitrariness that is inclusive. It put people of India back to the constitutional estate. Right? It's an inclusive arbitrary. Every judgment we make is arbitrary. Whether as judge, as scholar, as lovers, as housewives, as anything. We make arbitrary judgments, discretionary judgments. Because arbitrary means this is so because I like it to be so. That's all. That's what Bentham said. Pure will. But the will is constitutional will. To be more inclusive. So I call it creative judicial arbitrariness. SLRS. They are backslidings, I beg your pardon. Like Kausha. And now the Supreme Court has interpreted a petition. Like Lily Thomas, which overrules a half a century or more old rule, and that's not a ground of criticism, which overrules, which says if you are convicted, if you are a politician, you are convicted by district court, district versus magistrate, then electoral disqualification will apply to you. Now you want to remove corruption from politics. Is this the way to reverse the presumption of innocence on which your system of criminal law is based? That everybody is presumed to be innocent till found guilty beyond reasonable doubt. Lee Thomas thought less to reverse the profession. Bhopal, on which I've written for the last 31 years, enormous number of articles, they are there in the footnote in case you're interested. But Bhopal catastrophe, 31 years, and it is still turning 32. Now, settlement orders of judges of the Lordship of the Supreme Court in 2009, that will be seen to be believed. And Brother Beckett Talaya said to me, and in Jeremy judgment, little more politely, the Supreme Court had made a mistake. And therefore he said, I won't touch the amount, but I'll give you a post-judicial hearing. Because we were there before the Supreme Court as parties, and the thing was settled behind our backs by calling the Attorney General and Mr. Farid Nariman. We never heard. So we said, error goes to the root of the jurisdiction. You can't not hear us. He said, Bakshi, I'm giving you a post-judicial hearing. And he quoted to me, Merchant of Venice or Macbeth, I forget which. And I always say to Venkatacharya that little literature is a dangerous thing. Little of everything is dangerous. But little of literature is fatal. Because what did Macbeth say? He said to do, Lady Macbeth said, to do a great wrong, said Brother Venkatacharya, to do a great right, a little wrong is permitted. Great right to whom? And little wrong to whom? When you settle an industrial disaster, which Judge Kinnan described as the largest peacetime disaster in the world. Little wrong to the victim? Anyway, so there are backslidings in the masterless. The court has not consistently exercised creative judicial arbitrariness. It's exercised occasionally raw judicial discretion, which amounts to judicial despotism. And therefore, SRC or social responsible criticism, we avoid despotism. Despotism of judges is not demonstrational leadership. Creative judicial arbitrariness is. Finally, I end by quoting Schiller, and I urge you to remember that line, which is engraved on my heart. He's still a German poet. Schiller said, the task before you is, I better read what he says rather than inscribe myself. He said, "A What is left undone 1 minute is restored by no eternity. What is left undone 1 minute is restored by no eternity. And with this, Dr. Basu would have surely agreed. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for that enlightening lecture. I would now like to open the floor for questions from the audience.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I have two questions. First, sir, you quoted, you said that there were two things that were very wrong with the NJC itself. But if we read and go through the judgments, all the judges agree that there is something wrong with collision. So don't you think that the middle path here would have been correct, striking down those things which were very wrong and which takes away the judicial supremacy in appointments? But along with that, we could have upheld the NJC along with working, like we could have suggested that other methods. And second, do you think that there is a limit to demisprudence in your point of view? Like, where is the limit that we stop? Sir, do you think that there is a limit to demisprudence? Like, yesterday or day before yesterday, Supreme Court gave a judgment saying that officers in private banks are also public officers and hence can be investigated under Prevention of Corruption Act. So, do you think that there is a limit to demisprudence as such, or there isn't?
Judiciary constituting or strengthening the democracy, echo of the whole counter-majoritarian role of judges in strengthening the democracy. Now, in that context, my worry to a certain extent, especially looking at the recent anti-labor decisions of the court, that given the general conservative class character of the judiciary, aren't we in danger of undermining the socialist welfare principles of the constitution if we allow courts to move away from legislative mandate? And when I see cases where the courts have explicitly gone against legislative mandate, should we see demonstrations that you spoke of it and the counter-majoritarian role of courts always as a positive factor? And given the class character, that should we see it as a structural weakness of the judiciary itself?
Just like to extend this question by asking you about the limits of demisprudence in respect of the concept of constitutionalism. Since if the court is transcending their boundaries to the governance aspect, then they are to be limited with the concept of constitutionalism. So if you can throw light on that.
Good evening, sir. So you've written a lot about radical humanism. So I'd like to know, to what extent do you think the Supreme Court actually looks at radical humanism, and to how do you think the Supreme Court can actually develop and expand on this concept of radical humanism in its forthcoming judgments?
Legitimately, about the limit of the students of leadership, one comment indicated that with regard to death of labor law, that the Supreme Court, in fact, cannot be trusted because there's, as Nambudri Pass said long ago, it is a class character of its own. And Hidayatullah connected in a judgment, the only judgment in the world where the Supreme Court of a nation says it understands Marxism, Leninism better than the appellant. And Hidayatullah organizes a lecture, Nambudri Pass, on what he thinks is Marxism. It's a very interesting dialogue between judicial Marxism and political Marxism and how they differ. And I've given the first chapter of my long forgotten book, Marx, Law and Justice, to this very dialogue between Hidayatullah and Nambudri Pass. It was published before some of you were born in 93, but it's irrelevant. Now, I first work the limits there are. I'll come to the labor law question in a second. Let me do my sums publicly. I myself said limits have to come. From where do they have to come is the question. One can argue that they should come from the legislature. Now legislature always since Gulagran, Justice Gajendralkar, tall man, he was actually tall, but tall otherwise also. He said of Gulagnath that it was a self-inflicted wound. Does the limit come, as Indira Gandhi sought to impose it, through the notion of committed judiciary? And I asked Mrs. Gandhi, committed to what, madam? She said, committed to constitution. And I said, madam, what is constitution? Accepting what judges say it is. And she didn't like it, and she turned to somebody else to answer me. And that person answered even worse than the Indira Gandhi. That's a different matter. So, the limits could have come from Parliament, a representative institution of the people. Now, Mr. The present Prime Minister said he represents 1.25 billion Indians. Is it possible? I had a longer julfe and little younger than a woman called Tarkeshwari Sinha from Bihar. She was a beautiful woman. I know you something about beauty? No, no. and a woman. He Tarkeshwari ji came out, the dean of the law school, and said, ghazals after ghazals of my julfe. And I said, Tarkeshwari ji, please stop. I'm a common teacher. Aap kuch aur baat, ye desh ki baat kijiye. Said, all right, professor, I'll talk about the country. And she said, can you answer this question? Then I'll talk about India. At that time, we had 770 million people. He said, can you talk with 770 Indians inside your mouth? Answer is, you can't. So this idea of representation is a necessary social illusion. You can't, I don't know whether you represented anybody. So when you say counter-majority, who is the majority? Unless you can answer this question by saying, and some people have, right, Brother Bhanu Mehta has answered this question. He said judicial sovereignty is all wrong. He's a political scientist. He was. I mean, he writes for the Express also. But the real Brother Bhanu, academic, he said judicial sovereignty takes away the power of representative institution to decide what is demos, in my words. Demos leadership should always be with the legislature. I said, fine. Does the legislature not have the class character? Are judges having the same class character as the legislature? I would leave you to decide. So I would say limits have to be found by trial and error by the judiciary to their own demonstrational leadership. That demonstrational leadership is a fact. It is that they are exercising. They have got the powers to co-govern the nation today. Since 1980, they are co-governing the nation. Like legislature, they achieved. That's a fact of Indian life. It may be anti-majority, it may not be, it is a matter of opinion. But it is a fact of life that they are exercising demonstrational leadership. And they will continue to do so. Can you read Rajendra Babu's lecture, Basu lecture last year, in your own journal? So, they may make mistakes, and I think death of labor law and jurisprudence, which the Supreme Court itself created, is a major rollback in demonstrational leadership. And you will see that over a period of time, in fact, Umar Devi judgment, which denied contract workers their right to be appointed after 20 years in a central government institution, Justice Balasubramanian. In a second judgment that followed, 4 months later, their lordship gave the contract laborers the right to be employed by the same employer where they served more than 15 years. So Supreme Court speaks with many voices, not with one voice. So one has to study it. But you are right, the backslidings do occur. And what is curative petition? If not a way of admitting that we may be mistaken. How many times have you heard it from Parliament or from the executive that they are mistaken? In your lifetime, how many times anybody, how many prime ministers have said they were mistaken, they were wrong? How many ministers have said they were mistaken? They represent the people, but they are not wrong. So, curative petition is the admission by the Supreme Court. Epistolary jurisdiction is admission by the court. They had a class character. They are telling a different chapter. They are learning from the past mistakes, where they developed only property jurisprudence and self-regarding jurisprudence. And who is standing against globalization today in various aspects? If not the courts, I mean Supreme Court, High Court, who are giving injunctions against environmental terrorism. So in a sense, I agree that the Supreme Court has to be clear about limits to its constitutional leadership. It has to be clear. It has to correct mistakes that are apparent on the face of record. Can be done either by law review articles or by curative petition. But Supreme Court as a whole, as an institution, is capable of course correction and self-learning, collective self-learning, which other institutions are not shown a history of. That's my opinion, I may be wrong. But no representative institution actually represents people of India today. They claim to represent, but their claims have to be examined in the light of demonstrations. The judges, forgive me for going on, but long time back, before some of you were born in 82, Adam Singh Solanki was the chief minister of Gujarat. And he asked me, he said, Professor Bakshi, I want to understand one thing. I said, yes, chief minister, what is it? He said, should judges interfere with the administration? And I looked at him and said, they should not interfere with administration. If there is any. But if there is no administration, the judges will issue directions as well. And they are issuing directions. And then you say overreach. Then you say class character. My friend, erstwhile friend Manmohan Singh used to say, Lakshman Rekha, overreach, judicial overreach. I'm a woman, practicing woman. I used to cook. I can't cook now, but I used to cook. My wife will testify. We have in kitchen, Indian kitchens, a Lakshman Rekha, which is something that you line up to avoid cockroaches, kill them. Our judiciary, the statutory prime members of judiciary, cockroaches. What is that which is overreach? The other kind of Lakshman Rekha goes back to Ramayana. Then Lakshman do ask me to come and say you are not overreaching. And Sita being Sita, overreaching. Right? Now what wrong did Sita commit? Counter-majoritarian? Overcoming the limit? What are we? A no greater myth, and I miss Justice Rubha Palumad turning back to it. He holds that position, I hold my position. Justice Rubha Pal is a strong believer in separation of powers. And I said, there is no such thing under the Indian Constitution. There is no strict separation of powers in the three wings of state. Since 1951, in Delhi Laws Advisory Act came, and 55, Ramjabaya Kapoor was the state of Punjab. Signed it into the state. The only division of function, judicial function, there is register function, executive function. There is a question of limit, is a question for the court. And you can have feel responsible for the system. You can help the court to recognize the error of the way, particularly labor justice. Many of us are concerned, and many of us are fighting in the street, many of us are holding permanent people tribunals, many of us are going to the court. It's not a dead issue. It's a different issue than before, because none of the activists can provide employment. Only industry can provide employment. So it's a wider issue, but the issue of gay women, and that's a bad tragedy. I think I have generally tried to reach all the comments that I received, but others have noted now, and I'll surely think about it.
Thank you so much, sir. I would now request the Honourable Vice Chancellor to present sir with a shawl and a memento from as a token from NUJS. Advisor of the Constitutional Law Society, Ms. Professor Shamik Sen, to come and tell us about the D.D. Basu Endowment Lecture Essay Competition.
Well, after that thought-provoking speech by Professor Bakshi, I'm at a loss of words. But I have been asked to introduce to you this very exciting exercise that we did for about 4 years now, which is the National Essay Competition, named after Honorable Late Justice Durgadas Basu. Now, for the last 3 years, this competition was confined to the students of NUJS, and we got remarkable response. Now this year we decided to get a little adventurous. We decided to make it a national level essay competition. And to our surprise, maybe not so much, we got a number of entries from all around India. In fact, there were 52 in number. The topic of the essay was very contemporary. It was about the disqualifications to the membership of the legislature. You know, of course, the immediate motivation of having this topic was the Supreme Court deciding the Rajbala judgment. We got entries from all around India, national law schools, not so national law schools, traditional law schools, all of them. And it is also a matter of pride that the quality of the essays were generally superb. As a teacher of constitutional law, when I was going through those essays, you know, I was in fact in two minds that maybe what we can do is, as model essays, we could give it to our students. They should actually write their projects based on such content-rich essays. But then, of course, I thought that since they were so content-rich, that is why probably they have found their place in the top tier of such national level essay competitions. Independently, I had the proud opportunity of evaluating those essays, 12 of them, and Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Bhatt had also evaluated 12 of them, and it was found out that the evaluation that I had met, and completely independent of my evaluation, the evaluation that Professor Bhatt had met exactly matched. So based on two completely independent evaluations, we have the prize winners for the essay. We are giving a first prize, a second prize, and two consolation prizes. Interestingly enough, the four prize winners are from four different universities in India, four different law universities in India, which also, and this is again, this was completely anonymously done. Therefore, this also provides, you know, this also proves that this essay competition was truly representative of the national character that it had. I would, on behalf of the Constitutional Law Society, request Dr. Sharadindu Basu, if you can kindly hand over the prizes. We will, I'll announce the names of the winners. Now, unfortunately, again, since the winners are from different parts of the country, we do not have all of them with us today. We'll definitely put up their names and, you know, adequately publicize it, and we'll send over the prizes to them in their respective institutions. The consolation prizes are won by Ms. Minal Garg of the University Institute of Legal Studies, Punjab, Chandigarh. And yes, and Anushree Raizada of Symbiosis Law School, Pune. The second prize is to be awarded to Kritika Goyal of Gujarat National Law University, Gandhinagar. And the first prize winner is right here with us today. Anantrika Chaudhary. Trust me, her essay is fantastic. I must, you know, as her teacher, both sir and I, we feel ourselves, you know, we feel proud ourselves that she has written such an amazing essay. Congratulations, sir. Society organizes every year, and this is a legislative drafting competition. So again, the students step into the shoes of parliamentarians and draft a model law on a certain subject of contemporary relevance. This time the subject of the model law was about drafting a draft privacy law, especially for newsworthy celebrities. Now, the second prize of this legislative drafting competition, oh, before that, I would request Honorable Justice Tolun Chatterjee to kindly hand over the prizes. The second prize for the legislative drafting competition goes to Sarath Ninan Matthew. Are you here? Yes, there it comes. And the other person who has got the second prize is Rishabh Monod. Was fantastic. The winner of the competition is, of course, not from the first year. Oh, you are right here. Ayushi Singhal. she's already geared up for the Harvard Smith MOOC. So, we'll let her start working on it. Thank you very much. And thank you very much, Justice Chatterjee. And we would, and this is a request from the Constitutional Law Society to the entire students' body, that next year we want even more participation from NUJS in both these competitions. Please cooperate with us on both the legislative drafting as well as the D.D. Basu Memorial Essay Competition. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I would now like to request Justice Tarun Chatterjee to deliver the presiding remarks on the lecture.
Professor Bakshi, Vice Chancellor Mr. Bhatt, Mr. Dr. Basu, and students of NUJS. I'm extremely happy that you have invited me to be present to hear out the speech of Professor Bakshi. I'm not an educator like Bakshi or others, but I'm a very common human being. More so, when I was a lawyer in Calcutta High Court, I was really a civil lawyer, not a constitutional expert. Even then, I have done some constitutional cases in High Court as a lawyer and as a judge, and also as a judge of the Supreme Court. I have heard about Dr. Justice late Basu, Dr. Basu's father, from my father, who was also a judge when he was a judge in the Calcutta High Court. And I have heard also that he used to play sitar. He used to play sitar, am I right? Sitar all the time, and whenever someone goes there, he used to say wait, and then that gentleman hears the sitar and then go away. He was a great scholar, great man, and a great judge. And I'm extremely happy about this occasion. I have been invited to be present with Professor Bakshi here. Dr. Justice Basu has written the constitution of so many volumes, so many parts, and all subject and all articles of constitution, and therefore, and it was recognized by all over the world, not only India. Whenever we are student, we used to purchase his book. Whenever we are lawyers, we used to purchase his book. And whenever we were judges, we have taken loan from the High Court Library and also Supreme Court Library and used this book. Nothing can be said about his book because I am too small to say on this. Something about the NJAC is very difficult because, as far as I know, it has not yet been reported in any of the journals that are available in India, excepting in the internet. This is about 555 pages judgment, out of which Jessica Hale, I have seen, has written why he has not recused from this judgment. About that one, that it was about 20 to 25 pages. I don't know why we should write 20 pages on that. If according to me, of course, if someone raises any objection, anything against me about my ability to deal with that case or some personal interest or something like that, why should I be a party to that particular case? In any case, in this case, I have seen Justice Dave has accused himself, and for that reason, Mr. Justice Kahir has already given his reasons why he has not recused. I am very happy that Dave has accused because of some reasons, because of he was in the collegium. I remember one incident when I was in Supreme Court and in the collegium. A case came up before us that was regarding this present Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Nath Modi, and regarding that Godhra dispute, and I took up that case and decided when I was there with Justice Balasubramanian. I do not find that any reason for why Justice myself would recuse from this case. The case was a private litigation, although there was no petition before us. I remember Mr. Justice Subramaniam, Mr. Gopal Subramaniam, the same Solicitor General at that time, mentioned before me about this case, and we issued notice, and thereafter we started hearing this case. First we appointed one lady SP to inquire about that position, and then finally we found that nothing could be done because she was a police officer and the police people were involved, and that's the reason finally we thought that this should go to the CBI. From that, I find there was no reason for me to say that I will accuse myself from that case also because of that reason. I remember as talking about this position of that's why some judgments of the Supreme Court are having a side for the laborers, and some of them are from the owner's side. I know you will also understand there is another act that is Rent Control Act in India, and in Rent Control Act, I won't mention the judge's name now. The judge was sitting with me at that time, and I was taking up these rent control matters in the Supreme Court. In the specialty petitions, they as soon as that particular judge, of course I should not say this here, but even then I feel like saying, whenever I found that the particular case was filed by the landlord, that particular judge, my colleague in the bench, immediately, without going into it, any discussion, issued notice, whereas the case where the petitioner was tenant, I found, he started saying, "Dada, please reject it." So this was the position in Indian Supreme Court, and I personally feel that the judgments which are being passed in NJAC and the others are really some connection with personal problems. One more thing I would say before I end is that I'm very happy that you are a student of law and studying law, but I do not know why the students of NJAC, why they are not joining the profession, instead they are going to corporate society. I request them to take up the profession seriously and go ahead with the profession. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. I would now like to request the Honorable Registrar to deliver the vote of thanks.
I feel honored and privileged to get an opportunity to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion of 9th Durgadas Basu Endowment Lecture. I, on behalf of the NUJS, convey deep regards and hearty thanks to Professor Upendra Bakshi, Professor of Law in Development, Warwick University, for delivering the endowment lecture. We are greatly encouraged by his presence and immensely benefited by his inspiring address. I wish to express our profuse thanks to Honorable Mr. Justice Tarun Chatterjee, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, for presiding over the lecture and for his continued support of the activities of the university. We are extremely grateful to Dr. Sardindu Basu for supporting us in conducting yet another dates edition of Durgadas Basu Endowment Lecture. My thanks to our Vice Chancellor Professor Dr. P. Iswarabhat for his encouragement, guidance, and for providing a stimulating environment for conducting such activities. I also wish to express my sincere thanks to the faculty members at NUJS for training the students extremely well in this regard. I thank the non-teaching staff and NUJS administration for all the support they have extended for the program. I thank the Constitution Law Society and its members for organizing the lecture. Now the most important, I thank all the members in the audience, including NUJS students, for attending the program and asking extremely stimulating questions. Thank you all very much.
I would again like to thank the dignitaries for joining us today. It was truly an enlightening experience for all of us.